Hello, everyone. Welcome to the panel on metrics and innovation. My name is Jean Chen, and I'm a correspondent for Forbes magazine. Today, I'm delighted to be joined by Jager McConnell.
Thank you.
CEO of Crunchbase.
That's right.
A news publisher and e-tech industry data provider. For those of you new to Crunchbase, its database contains background information and the fundraising history of well over 500,000 companies. Jager joined Crunchbase in 2015, right? And after 11 years at Salesforce, a very well-known San Francisco-based cloud computing company. So, Jager, welcome.
Thanks.
Let me start off by asking you, what kind of metrics do you use to determine whether a startup is successful?
Sure. So it really depends on what stage of a company you're in, right? It really depends on what type of company you are, what stage that you're in. For example, when you are a Series C, Series A, very early in your life, you don't necessarily know what products, even if you have the right product yet. Do you have product market fit? So the metrics you're going to be looking at are very much around customer satisfaction, right? Net promoter score, NPS scores. Do people like what they're using? Are they telling their friends about how great your product is? That's a great early stage metric. But as you get a little bit later in a company's life cycle, other metrics become much more important or increasingly more important. Things like your magic number. So there's a stat called the magic number, which is essentially your capital efficiency. How much money are you putting into developing product and selling your product, and how much revenue do you get because of that effort? That's a very important metric as you get into Series B, Series C, Series D. Please, if you're a Series C or a Series A company, you should not be thinking about it all. Your capital efficiency doesn't matter when you are a very young company. That's why focusing on NPS score or just even a customer satisfaction score of any type is a good place to start to hear from your users. They are happy. And if they are not happy, use that metric as an indicator to go and start iterating on your product, figuring out why, because that's what's important at that earlier stage.
Okay, do you have specific metrics that you can use as examples right now?
Sure. I mean, so let's say we double click on MPS, the MPS score. Okay. So I don't know how many of you know what an MPS score is, just so I can calibrate on the audience.
Wow.
Cool. So a decent number. And should we do an MPS score on how this presentation is going so far? For the people that don't know, you essentially ask your customers, would you recommend our product to your friends? And it's give it a scale from 1 to 10. And if it's a 9 or a 10, that means they are our promoter and they like your product and they're willing to go and spread the word about your product. That's a good thing. Anything below a 6 is a detractor. Those are people who don't like your product enough to go and, sorry, but, yeah, below a 6, a detractor to go and say, I don't really like this product. They're going to lose sales because they're talking about how bad your product is. You don't want those. And then in between is a 7 and 8 that it doesn't actually go one way or the other. It's sort of neutral because they might like your product. They may not unsubscribe from it, but they aren't going to go and actively solve the problem. And so if you look at MPS as an example, a lot of people, younger companies, focus on how do we optimize that score? How do we make that as high as possible? But what they don't do is look at the curve of what's the distribution of the numbers over that MPS score. And that actually can be very, very telling. If you look at if you have a distribution curve like a horseshoe, it means that some people love your product and some people hate your product. And what that probably means is that you need to focus your sales organization to sell the product that you're successful with. What is different about those users opposed to the people that hate your product? If you have a, but and that score Let's say that's an NPS score of a 20. You can also get an NPS score of a 20 by having a huge spike of sevens and eights and a few nines and tens. And they have no one underneath six. So like that's an interesting sort of conundrum. Like, and what does that mean? It means that your product is okay, you're selling to the right users, but you haven't quite figured out your product market fit yet. You need to figure out how to go and optimize your product a little bit better to go and be more valuable so they're more likely to stay put and then ultimately tell their friends about it. So that's an example of how metrics, if you get too in the weeds, if you just focus at the number without really understanding what's driving those numbers, can mislead your startup in a way that's not healthy for your organization.
But of all these metrics, are they already used by traditional companies?
Yeah, I mean, I think it depends, of course, on the company and on the metric. Most of these metrics do carry over pretty nicely into traditional sort of non-SaaS companies. The nice thing is that the public markets kind of helped to drive this metric conversation if you go back far enough, so that everyone's sort of speaking the same language. Do you have a strong enough business? I think Coca-Cola, as an example, probably knows what their NPS score is of what Coke is, just as much as Facebook knows what their NPS score is. So it really depends on the business, but I would say most apply across the board.
But there's the key question. How much should we trust metrics?
Yeah, I'm pretty opinionated on this. Metrics are super valuable to a point. And I see a lot of, it's interesting, there are some businesses, I've actually spoken to a number here today, where they have no idea what metrics they have. Like, they're thinking about starting a company, they're thinking about raising money, and you go and ask them, how much are you spending on acquiring your customers? What's your CAC, customer acquisition cost? And they have no idea. It doesn't even matter if it's good or bad, but you should at least know how much you're spending on finding customers and then start figuring out how to optimize that. Another good example might be, again, that magic number. How many of you are founders or run companies today, regardless of size? Raise your hand.
Wow.
Cool. How many of you know off the top of your head what your magic number is? Not a surprise, because I think most of the companies here are probably too young again for that. But it's that calculation is a good thing to understand, because you can calibrate the smallest possible company to the largest possible company. Like, right. I can go and look at a Salesforce, and their magic number is probably 0.7 or 0.8. You go and look at a startup, it might be like 0.1. If you're a really good startup, you might be like 1.5. Mm-hmm. And knowing how you are compared to the other businesses may not make it less, like, it may not matter for you in your everyday world, but when you think about raising your next round of funding, when you go and talk to an investor and you go and they ask you that question, it looks like you've got your shit together. When you can go and tell them what the number is, know how your business is doing. And that's why metrics matter in the sense that you should know about them. But the important part of your question is how do you choose which metric matters, right? What are the metrics that matter to your business? Super important, I can't answer the question for you, but you don't get distracted by there's 1,000 metrics to go and look at, and you're looking at all of them, and you just cherry pick the ones that are the best for you. Which are the ones that indicate your business are doing well? So that's part of it. And then there's another aspect of metrics, this is kind of the title of the panel here, is that, if you just look at metrics, your company is going to die. And that is a scary thing. If you think about a company, let's say your metrics are amazing, and you high-five each other all day long, look at how great our metrics are. How are you innovating? How will you know what the next feature is that you're going to go and build? How do you know that a competitor is not building something that's way better than you have that's going to go and wipe you out? I'll bet you, prior to Facebook, MySpace's metrics were amazing, right? MySpace was Facebook before Facebook. They were, I used it, everyone used it. That was the thing, and it was pretty actively used. And out of nowhere, Facebook wiped it out. And why? You can argue as to why, but I think it's because they had the photo sharing features and being able to tag your friends in the photos. That was all brand new. And no metric that some product manager at MySpace was looking at would see that coming. And you need to be aware of that.
Okay, Jager, then tell me about a company that looked good on paper, but actually fails.
I mean, again, MySpace is probably the best example. They looked great on paper. Who was it? Like Justin Timberlake, when I put like $100 million into MySpace, right? And then it just is dead. Who uses it? Does anyone here use MySpace? Oh, come on. I don't believe you. The one person raised his hand as a joke. And had you asked this same question back in 96 maybe, or no, long, 2005, 2006, like in that sort of time zone, every hand would have gone up here.
Do you have more recent example?
Sure. Like I think if you think about, it's always tough to choose companies that still exist as good or bad examples, but like I think Groupon is probably a good example. They're a public company. They're worth $3 billion they're worth about $3 billion right now. And they're doing fine as far as revenue goes. But if you look at their metrics, I'll bet you back when they were the hot thing and they were worth 20 times more than what they're worth now, the metrics were amazing. It was a fad. It felt good, right? Mm-hmm. But now that fad has passed. Like, that's already gone. Another good example is probably, and again, I don't know their metrics, but the Pokemon Go. Like, that was a huge thing. Overnight, it was making billions of dollars. Mm. And, like, huge hordes of people would walk through Central Park with their little Pokemon Go game trying to find the next Pokemon. Does anyone still play it? I don't know. How many of you play Pokemon Go today? No one. Ooh. How many of you have ever played Pokemon Go? Come on, be honest. Look, so these are the people that used to play, and those metrics looked amazing, but the people that ran Pokemon Go did just look at, maybe, I'm just speculating, but just probably looked at those metrics and didn't realize that this was a fad. How do we stay on top of it? How do we go and capitalize off of it? And that's how watching just metrics can actually be the death of your company.
Okay. And Jager, let's talk about innovation. When it comes to innovation, is Asia a leader?
Sure. So I some of you hopefully saw it. I did a center stage presentation earlier today, and it would be naive to say that Asia is not a center of innovation when there's more capital. Over $50 billion went into Asia in venture capital in 2016 compared to about $26 or $27 billion going to Silicon Valley. And that's the first time that has ever happened, where the amount of capital going into Silicon Valley was less than what was going to Asia. And that's because investors are figuring out that the innovation is happening here. And investors and the money will just go where they can make the most money. And with Asia, with its incredible rate of education for people, for students focused on STEM education, that is the hub of how innovation starts.
Okay, then in what areas does Asia excel?
I think it would be not fair for me to go and say it's this specific area that Asia excels. But if you are a business in Asia, if you could build a business around consumer goods, obviously if you can sell something to people in Asia, there are a lot of people in Asia, you are successful, you have an high NPS score, you are very likely going to go and make a lot of money. So I would say, you think about the car sharing services, right? Mm-hmm. Or the bike sharing services, obviously. Like, these are unicorns that exist today in Asia because they are servicing the consumers of Asia in a scalable, workable way. And that's a good way how looking at metrics can confirm for you that you have a product that can spread across the continent. But one of the questions that you need to ask yourself is, even if you have a product that everyone loves, that, again, this is another thing that metrics won't tell you. Your metrics say your product is well-loved, everyone wants it. How do you scale your business to actually go and satisfy the billions of people that you're trying to address with your consumer good product? That's that's something that you need to have, like distribution and a strategy and a marketing strategy of how you go and spread your product around. And like, again, no metric is going to tell you that. You need to come up with that uniquely. And again, as I was talking to startups here yesterday and the day before, these are companies that have a good idea. They've got a good strategy as far as what the product should be, but they don't actually go and have an idea of how to distribute it and how to actually target their different countries.
So, Jager, are you saying innovation, whatever it is more important than measuring metrics?
Oh, absolutely. I think, you know, metrics if you have an innovative, if you do not have something interesting and novel and something that is defensible by being so innovative, what's stopping anyone else from just stealing your idea? You could have great metrics. I can just go and build another one of the things if I'm just not innovating at all. You need to have something that's different, something that's powerful. That's why there's a patent system. You know, how do you go and protect the IP that you've created? Because that's ultimately what's going to drive value into your business.
Right. But with so much innovation, so much technology, so much useless technology, a lot of people think many apps are useless.
Sure.
What do you say to that?
They are. I mean, they're absolutely right. If what you don't hear about, like the iOS App Store, or the Android App Store, you hear about how many apps there are. How many of them are actually making money? How many of them actually have usage? How many of them have? Mm. This is where metrics do matter. What the DAU average is across all of the apps in the App Store? I'll bet you it's just remarkably, embarrassingly low because there are so many bad dead apps.
Okay, and finally, what kind of advice do you give to Asian startups in order to stay ahead, to get ahead?
Yeah, I think, you know, it's a good question.
About using metrics, of course.
Yeah, using metrics. I think, again, understand what your metrics are, understand what the metrics are that matter to you. And when you talk to investors, you need to spend the time to educate them as to why those particular metrics matter to your business. That's what they don't know about your business, and it's on you to be able to explain that to them so that they don't look at the metrics that don't matter. And that's probably my best advice around metrics.
Great. I'm afraid we are running out of time. Thank you, Jager.
My pleasure.
To everyone in the audience, thank you. Thank you for coming.
Great. Thanks a lot.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.